Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. I'm really excited to be here. So before I go into anything else, I want to show you just a picture of some of the students that have been working over the last few years in my lab. As you can see, they're all bending down in some optical table, playing with some instruments. We actually build all the instruments, and you'll see some of them later on. But we build our own instrumentation. And even though I'm a chemist, I'm really in the boundary between chemistry and physics. What I do is optics applied to materials. So we go from developing instrumentation to actually doing some of the, we don't really do chemistry in the sense that we don't mix solutions and we don't break and make bonds, but we do photochemistry. So what I want to talk about today, and my little thing is not going to work, so I'm going to be nearby. It's about how do we harvest energy with synthetic materials. But before I even go into the details of what I'm doing, I want to get a little bit of understanding of why we go into this field. So if we think about Earth, we live here. We're going to try to live here for a few more thousand years, hopefully. The closest part of the atmosphere that is near to us is the troposphere. And the troposphere, it's about, 12 kilometers. As a scientist, I don't use English units, that's a lie. But 12 kilometers, and the temperature in here actually varies. It varies from the bottom of the troposphere close to us, and as you get higher and higher, it gets lower. But what's more interesting and more useful for us as living creatures is that on the troposphere, we actually have a whole bunch of gases, water, nitric oxide, methane, CO2, that keep the temperature of the Earth stable. And the way that they keep it stable, it's not, it's actually by interacting with Earth itself. So if you actually think about getting light from the sun, I have to get used to this, of 100% of the light that comes out of the sun, about 25% of it is actually reflected by the clouds, and the clouds are on the troposphere. And then of whatever remains in there, about 50%, or actually 50% of the 100, reach the Earth. Of that 50%, 45 gets absorbed in some sort of process within the Earth, and then 5% more gets reflected. Now, what happens with that 45%? It's everything from photosynthesis to warm it us up, okay? But once these energies all absorb for all the living creatures, some of that is radiated back. The issue is that the energy that is radiated back is not radiated back at the same with the same colors, with the same frequencies. It's actually radiated back on the infrared. And that energy that is radiated back on the infrared is absorbed by all these gases that are on the troposphere. That's what allows us to live at what we call, what we consider to be good temperatures, about 18 to 20 Celsius. That's sort of the average temperature on the Earth. If we didn't have all these gases that serve as a buffer between us and the rest of the atmosphere, we would actually be like 20 below. And it will not be easy to maintain life. So the fact that we actually have all these gases in here, it's a good thing. They absorb some of the energy that is reflected, and that allows us to maintain the temperature. The problem is that if we look at the temperature of that atmosphere on the, in here, it's just on the last 100, about 130 years or so, what we see is that there's been a huge rise, and this is in here, the difference in the temperature between what's sort of an average around the 1950s and what was the temperature before, and we can see that from about here on, it keeps rising and rising and rising. So that in itself might not be a problem because, okay, we're looking at about 100 or so years. What is the problem in that case? The problem is that when we look farther back, we see that the blood in here shows the temperature difference. Now we are talking about hundreds of thousands of years. And when we look at how the temperature changes in the Earth over hundreds of thousands of years, we can see that it fluctuates. Okay? And this fluctuation is part of nature. Again, not a problem in there. And we also know that together with this fluctuation, we actually have a fluctuation in the amount of the CO2 gas on the troposphere. And this is the curve that you see on the top. And if you're careful enough, you can see that, for example, this maximum is a little bit on the right-hand side of the blue one. So the temperature rises a little bit, but this is a good indicator of what's happening with temperature. So there's a correlation between changes in the temperature and changes of the carbon dioxide. Over the last 800,000 years, this temperature fluctuates at about an average of, I don't remember exactly the number, but I think it's about an average of 250 ppm. The units in here, which I guess I blocked, the units in here are parts per million of air. So it fluctuates around there, and these fluctuations are no problem. You know, the ice age and things like that, not a big deal in there. The problem comes when we look at the same parameters since on the last 2,000 years. And what we see in there is that we start, if you look at the red curve, that corresponds to the amount of CO2 on air, and it's the same unit, you can see that it starts, this point in here kind of corresponds to a point in here, around 260 or so. And it stays, it keeps, you know, remains in there. Now, here we talk about hundreds of thousands of years. Here we are talking about 2,000 years, okay? So it keeps pretty much constant, and then it just goes, you know, bananas, right? It goes completely bananas. How bananas it goes? Well, if we actually look at that measurement, this is sort of the measurement about now, 2005. So these are data that's been collected and sort of updated with time. I look at the latest number. 2005, the amount of CO2 on air was about 380 ppm. 2008, it was 390. And if you listen to the radio, you probably listened that about 6 months ago, we went above off scale because we went about 400 ppm. So changes that in here occur in, if you look at how fast this goes up, you're talking about 25,000 years for the CO2 to go up a few ppm. If you look about this curve in here, it's just shooting up, okay, and not ending. What can we expect from that? Well, we can expect that the temperature on the Earth is going to keep rising and rising. And why is that? Because this buffer that the CO2 does, this idea of reabsorbing the energy that gets emitted back from the Earth, gets stuck on the CO2 that is on the atmosphere. And if we actually increase the amount of CO2, all that's going to happen is we're going to get warmer and warmer. What could we do about that? Well, we can think about what will happen if we change the amount of CO2 that we actually put out. And actually, maybe I should have made a comment in here. You know, none of us were born in here, but you might know what happened around the 17, 1800s.
The Industrial Revolution.
That it actually coincides when we started burning fuels, when we started burning coal and burning petroleum. So, of course, what we need to do is find some way of reducing the amount of CO2 on air. I mean, I don't think there's any argument on that. The question is, how do we deal with it, and how much do we need to reduce it? So what we have in here is the emissions on some units that are huge. There are gigatons of carbon per, you know, per year in emission. And these are three different models that have been calculated. The first one is, what happens if we continue the way that we are continuing our everyday life, if we don't do any changes? And what we see, that's the red curve, we see that the amount of CO2 will keep increasing and increasing in a uncontrolled way. On the other hand, we could say, well, let's go ahead and maintain the amount of CO2 exactly at the amounts that we have today. And if we do that, this is what we get, this blue curve in here. This is stable emissions, about 250, you know, in 2050. It's going to take us a few years to reach a place where we can get stable, but instead of increasing the rate of putting CO2 on the air, we stabilize it. And that would be the blue curve in here. The green curve in here, it's what happened is today, we pretty much shut off the world and said we're going to reduce CO2 by 80%. And that will really mean a change of our quality of life, because we are so used to, from driving a car to having the AC on, that to actually reduce 80% is not just really saying I want to be, I don't know, I want to be careful with the environment, but actually means a major change on our culture. But that will be this green curve in here. So we could think, okay, let's stabilize it. You know, let's go in here. Let's stabilize it to whatever values we'll have in 2050. The problem is that this is our emissions. This in here is how much CO2 we will have on the atmosphere following the three models. And we can see that, of course, if we keep increasing the rate of emission, this is going to go up, no doubt about it, the red one. The problem is that even if we stabilize the amount of CO2 that we emit, as for whatever is going to be on 2050, the amount of CO2 on the atmosphere is still going to keep going up. So that's not enough. It's not enough to say we are going to continue of whatever you're doing today but not increasing the rate. We actually have to do something more. And it's only by reducing 80% of the emissions that we generate today, you know, keeping only 20% of what we are doing now, that we stabilize the amount of CO2 on air to an about of a value of 550 ppm, which is much, much larger than what we have now. So you can see that the problem, it's serious. It's serious not because we can do something now to just say, let's not induce any more changes, but because we actually have to change to reduce how much CO2 we have on the atmosphere. So where is that CO2 coming from? It's coming from this, you know, what happens with the sources of the CO2 in the atmosphere. Most of it, it's because we are actually burning petroleum, because we are burning fossil fuel. There is an interesting way to look at this. It takes millions of years for the petroleum to actually be generated, and we've been burning it for about 160 years. So there's a difference on the speed of the velocity of those two cycles, the cycle that it takes to put things that have carbon on them underground and make them petroleum, to the cycle that it actually we are using on bringing all that CO2 outside on the atmosphere. The other big source is the fact that we are actually doing deforestation. It's not just an issue of how much we consume, but how much less green land we have within the Earth atmosphere, how much we are actually taking down trees. What it has in here, it's also two, I mean, I'm concentrating on this explanation on CO2. There are other, they are not the only gases that actually create the greenhouse effect. Methane, for example, it's much more effective on warming up the Earth, but there's a lot less. So we still have to deal also with the fact of how much methane we generate, and most of the methane that we're actually generated comes from feedstock and from manure, since we've been doing things, eating cows that we actually have on our ranches, then this amount increases quite a bit. But it's a lot more, at this moment, it's a little more controllable than it is the CO2. So to give you a perspective, I'm going to try to go from the world to the US to Florida. And I tried to get the values of Daytona, but I couldn't, so I got the values of home in Gainesville too. But if you actually look at the CO2 emission by country, we can see that we are one of the big creators of this problem. Now, somebody can look in here and say, oh, well, look, China emits more CO2 than we do. That is true now, but there are two things to keep in mind. One is that because we've been industrialized a lot faster than China, the accumulation of CO2 that we generated, it's many more times larger than the amount that China has generated so far. That doesn't mean that they're not going to do more, but at this point, we've put much more CO2 on the atmosphere than they have. And the other one is compare the populations. Compare the amount of CO2 that we put on the atmosphere by looking at the population of the US and the population of China. These numbers are at this moment very similar, and if you're at 300, I think they're at 1.2 billion, so they have four more times the amount of people that we do. So we clearly have to take into account, you know, our responsibility. I mean, there's a lot of politics on this always, and there's a lot of politics on say, well, let's look at China, let's look at India, because they're developing really, really fast. Well, let's first look at ourselves and see how much damage we've done. So I take this really, you know, when every time I go back and go to these plots in here, which most of them are taken from either EPA or the American Energy Institute or the NREL, I actually get really kind of scared when I look at the amounts, you know, the things that we are actually doing to the environment. But in essence, we are responsible for a lot of it, and it's really on us to try to fix part of the problem. What do we do? Why is it that, you know, how is it that we are putting so much CO2 and we are consuming so much of the energy? Well, what you have in here is what is called a plot of the energy flow. This is energy coming in and this is energy coming out. As I said at the beginning, I'm a scientist. I use metric notation. Well, all this, none of this, don't ask me why, but people keep using BTUs. Have you ever heard of a BTU? All right, British Thermal Unit, okay? One BTU, it's about 1,000 joules. I like those units better. But the idea is that we can see from where it's coming. It's coming from coal, natural gas, and petroleum, you know, most of it. Where is it going? There are four major branches in here: residential, commercial, industrial, and transportation. If you look at the different types of energy, where are they going? Transportation is mostly petroleum. Residential, which is going to be talking in the next few minutes, it's mostly electrical. That's sort of the major source of consumption for us. So as I said, the other interesting thing to notice is the fact that if we look at how much we, and this is the US, how much we produce versus how much we consume, you can see that they were not too different, these numbers, on the 1950s or 60s, but now we are, the production lags the consumption of it. On the other hand, and this is a plot that went to 2011, things have changed quite a bit in the last 15 years. We used to import a lot more than what we export. Now, with the whole fracking thing, the amount of energy that we are generating in-house, it's a lot larger, and we are importing less and less. All right, so going from the world to the country to our state. When we look at the state of Florida, in their residential, on the houses, the 90% of the energy that is used in a household, it's electrical, all right? So this is really what we are going to focus, because that's, we know, how do we generate that electricity is what we are important, how generation of that electricity actually produces CO2 that goes into the environment. Just as a comment, it is very common to hear about, you know, Florida's warm, this and that. We are only second to Texas in how much electricity we consume, and we are not the hottest state in the nation, okay? So the excuse that, you know, we are hot, not good enough. So this is the comparison of where the energy goes in our houses if we compare the US with the Southeast, the South Atlantic, which is from Delaware, DC, south here, you know, all that region, to Florida. And just a couple of things to make a comment about. The, you know, in the US, 6% of the energy, of the household energy, it goes through air conditioning. You can see that in Florida, it's about 30%. Makes sense, all right? But the other thing is that in, you know, the country, about 40% is actually heating. And for us, that's a very small percentage. But even that, this is, you know, four times the national average, and this is really one of the places that this is not too bad. This room, maybe because I'm moving a lot, but one of my biggest complaints in my office, back at UF, or almost in any building in Florida, is you walk in there and the AC is usually between 68 and 70, right? And it's like, why? Wouldn't we all be so much more comfortable if the AC was just maybe 72, 74? It would be dry and it would be perfect. Well, I think it's really up to us to start calling the physical plant and saying, look, you know, there's no need to actually keep a building at 68 when we can keep it at 74, and then this number will go down. All right, so I want you to actually go back home and look at some of the numbers, not on your dorm, or not, I mean, I don't know whether people living here still with their parents, that's what I did when I was in college, or whether you live on your own, but you can look at your electrical bill. And what you're going to notice is that we consume on average about 40 kilowatts per hour per day, and you can see that on your bill. That amounts to about 1.4 kilowatt hours a month. We are way above the US average, and even we are above the South Atlantic region. So we are really big consumers of electricity in our households. How do we generate all that electricity? In the state of Florida, we generated 76% of it by coal and 22% by natural gas. And these are two big producers of CO2. CO2 and methane, of course, you know, natural gas burning that. So what, it's not that I propose to do something, but this is sort of the little bug that tells me, okay, we need to do something about it. And as a scientist, what I can do is try to improve whatever it is that it's possible to generate electricity from other sources that are not going to be coal or natural gas. So when we look into that, of course, we look into renewable energy sources. And I want to make a point in the difference between renewable and sustainable. Does anybody, I mean, do you guys know what the difference is? Yeah.
Renewable is that the product can be replaced quicker than we can actually consume it. And what was it?
Sustainable.
And sustainable is that you are using the product at the exact same rate that it is producing itself.
There's one more thing in there. Renewable, when we actually burn biofuels, or when we burn biomass, like Gainesville now, it's getting all its energy from a biomass plant. We are actually burning something that is putting CO2 on the air. It's cleaner than other methods, but it's not completely clean. And that is renewable. It's completely renewable. You know, we're going to use it at a smaller rate that we can produce it. But it's not completely sustainable. Sooner or later, we're going to have to take into account the amount of CO2 that burning biofuel produces. Sustainable for Earth, at least, for the environment, it's something that is going to allow us to maintain that and not think that we're going to have, yes, to change it.
I was going to wait until you were finished, but I did want to ask. I hear a lot about the argument of hydrogen and using that and converting the water hydrogen molecules, and that they're trying to come up with something where they set hydrogen gas tanks on the side of the road so that
So hydrogen is one of the cleanest fuels that you can think about, okay? Because when you actually use it, what you get out of it is water, all right? So yes. Now, whether it's a tank or whether it's a material, you know, or whether there is a material that has the hydrogen absorb on it, I mean, how is the liver? It's a completely different issue. And actually, I personally think that that's where you guys come into play, because I think the next generation of research has to do more with storage of all these fuels than with the generation. You know, we know a lot about how to generate them, but not how to store them. But it is. I mean, hydrogen, and I have a slide that comes a little bit later that actually shows how do we generate hydrogen for you to use it as a fuel. That's a fuel that it will be sustainable. Because not only we could renew it, but also the products of it are not going to generate greenhouse gases. They generate water. Water is kind of a greenhouse gas, but it, you know, we have so much that we have an equilibrium on the amount of water. Okay. So you can look in here. These are all these are actually no, sorry, this one. All these are renewable sources of energy. Okay. If you expand in here, we go from solar PV. Geothermal, wind, biofuels, wood, this is biomass, hydroelectric power. Not all are completely clean. Not all are sustainable. Hydroelectric power is, you know, biomass is not as much because we're actually burning and generating a lot of CO2. So where do we go from here? We go into that little thing on top. We go into the idea that we can use solar energy as a way of having green and sustainable type of energy. Why is that? Because we can try to generate, because we can try to generate completely clean energy by actually using the amount of sun that gets into us. How much is that? The Earth uses about 12 times to the 12 watts per hour you know, that we actually use in amount of energy. And the sun puts out, or I think it's now at 15, something like that, that we consume. And the Earth puts about 120,000 terawatts of power in, you know, in on Earth. So the point is there's plenty of energy in there. It's an issue of being able to transform it in a way that we can use it for electricity or for fuels. And we'll look into both cases. So a little bit more detail in terms of PV, photovoltaics. This is, this is the number of companies that have been involved. You can see there is a huge jump on the manufacturing of photovoltaics on the in the US. What is really interesting is going back to my earlier comment about China. In 2002, 2004, around that time, China decided that was going to put a lot of money on photovoltaics. And within 10 years, they actually own the market now. I mean, they really are the biggest generators of photovoltaics devices. So it's really an issue of making a decision of investing in it and then seeing how an industry grows. One of the issues of, you know, this was from 2011, I believe, is this number that the Chinese, you know, the Chinese PVs take about 77% of the whole production. Two important parameters to take into account when we think about photovoltaics is the following. First of all, how long it takes for a household, if I think about putting photovoltaics on top of the roof of my house, how long it's going to take for my investment, which is a lot of money because PVs are still expensive, to pay back. It's going to take about this, again, I have to update this number because this number is for 3 years ago and the prices have gone down. So it used to be between 8 to 12 years. If you think that when you put the photovoltaics on your roof, they last for about 30 years, and that's the expectation, then you have 20 years in which it's gonna be good, be better for you in terms of the money. You know that there is this possibility now that instead of buying photovoltaics for your house, you can actually rent your space to a company. And what the company does is it comes to your home, puts the photovoltaics, and takes care of absolutely everything. And for as long as you need, you actually have the electricity for your house, and then they own your photovoltaics. So in terms of being accessible, it still requires being able to do something on your house, but it's getting easier and easier to install them. The other thing that is truly important is, and a question that you always want to ask, is whenever somebody comes and says, oh, this is a better way of generating energy, is how much energy was used in making whatever it is that you're making to generate more energy. And in the case of photovoltaics, that's called the energy payback time. There are different types of photovoltaics, and the energy payback is between 2 and 3 years. That means that the energetic cost of making the photovoltaic, because you have to make it, after 2 or 3 years, you pay off that amount of energy. And then for the rest of the 20-some years that you have your PV in there, you actually have completely clean energy being produced. The last thing that I will show in here is the fact that we are down here. And yes, we are not the place where the resources are the biggest, that's Arizona, but we are not too far from the top of the list in the US. So we are definitely a state that will benefit enormously from trying to go into photovoltaics. So having said that, we need to generate a cleaner way of generating energy. I actually do fundamental science. I do very, very fundamental science. You see in a few more slides. But I do it thinking that in one way or another, we are going to be able to help the next generation of solar resources. So what is it that we do? We look at organic photovoltaics. So there are two large families of photovoltaics. One family, which is the one that you've seen on the roofs now, which is the silicon photovoltaics. They're hard crystalline pieces. And the other possibility is to make it from organic compounds. And the major advantage of making them from organic compounds is the fact that you can make a photovoltaic that is flexible. And when you can make a photovoltaic that is flexible, you can imagine that you can cover any shape that you have in there. So instead of having to have it on your roof, you can have it on any surface. It doesn't have to be, you can print it on a plastic. It doesn't have to actually be a rigid surface. The efficiency, it's still not there. It's not comparable to silicon photovoltaics. And the pricing is still not there. But it's actually getting very close. It's actually improving enormously. So how does an organic photovoltaic works? It's made out of a sequence of specific components. First, you have some glass. It has to be transparent because the sun is going to come from here. I should have done it exactly the other way around so the sun comes from the top. But it's going to be illuminated from the bottom on this cartoon. There's going to be an electrode in here. Then there's going to be a light harvester, something that's going to absorb all the light that the sun has to offer us, or at least as much as possible. Then there's going to be some, these two materials can be organic, an acceptor of charge, an electron to accumulate the charge, and then hopefully you'll have electricity coming out. So if you look in here, the first step is the radiation of light. It creates an excitation, the material absorbs light. It creates an excitation in here. That excitation moves around and it gets into an interface. And on the interface, given the energetics of the interface in there, you can separate the electron from the hole. You can separate the electron from the ion. And by doing that, you can take that electron that moved faster than I could talk. You can take that electrode, it's going to be driven towards the aluminum metal in here, and then you're going to have your electricity coming out. That's the basic idea of any organic photovoltaic. We focused our research on trying to understand how the light harvesters works and what we can tell to people that make materials on what are the important properties of those light harvesting materials. And this is sort of a little picture of, you're going to see several of these later on, of the type of molecules that we studied. The other possibility is what she was mentioning before, the fact that we can use hydrogen as fuel. And the idea is to have light from the sun and then try to convert it in another form of energy. So you can create, you can make electricity, or you can use light from the sun to make fuels. And in this case in here, we will have the organic material in here. And this is really a cartoon of how this works, all right? There's no device that actually looks like this. And what you will have is the energy will be concentrated in here in a sink. And this sink will work as a catalyst to actually have either the oxidation of water on one end of the, or the reduction on the other one. And if you're able to do this, you're going to generate the hydrogen in here that then you can use to fuel, you know, as a fuel to use it for whatever else you want to do. You know, that will be how you store your energy that then you can use by burning it. Now, the idea is that the organic materials that we study are on this part of the system. They are the harvesting part of the system. And the important thing is to be able to have all this light that comes from the sun, to have it with different colors, to have a material in here that will absorb all those different colors, all those different frequencies, and have it all focused in one place where you can actually convert it in another form of energy. So what is it that we look for? We look for conjugated materials that allow us to do the light harvesting. We look at the electronic excitations, this idea that they will absorb light and you will get an excited, yes. What you have with organic materials is much more flexibility on modifying the chemistry to make it absorb where you want it. That's what it is. You can change a chromophore, and I'll show you in a slide or two. By just changing slightly a chromophore, you can change the absorption spectrum. That's flexibility. So we are going to look into electronic excitation, consider space and energy. We are going to look at when you look at a molecule. So when you think about inorganic material, it moves somewhat, but it's quite rigid. You can think about a crystalline system. When you look at a plastic, you actually look at something that is constantly be moving. So we have to take that into account. Yes?
Could you give a brief description as to what a chromophore is?
I'll tell you one. I'm going to actually go through it in detail. Yes. So and then we want to try to understand how is this processes of absorbing light and finally and concentrating spatially in one place. So let's look at what a chromophore is, because that's the beginning of everything. A chromophore is a chemical unit that will absorb light. Okay, that's what chromophore means. And the properties of the chromophore will depend on the chemical structure. And this will be for an inorganic compound or an organic compound, from anything in there. They will depend on what type of group. This is a benzene group. This is a triple bond, carbon, triple bond, carbon. This is another benzene group. And depending on the identity in here, I can put my sample, shine light, and see what colors that sample absorb. And that's going to give me the characteristics of the chromophore. So if I look at this chromophore in here, I can look at the absorption as a function of the wavelength of light. And if you know what the visible spectrum is, the visible spectrum actually starts somewhere in here. So what I'm going to be showing you are all chromophores that absorb in the UV, in an ultraviolet region. None of them, I think maybe there's one that absorbs on the visible, but all of the ones, the most of what I'm going to be working, they actually do absorb on the UV. So depending on the nature of this chromophore, they're going to absorb in different places. If I compare the red, which is repeated in here, you see that this absorbs all the way to 300 nanometers. But if I make this longer, I actually shift the spectrum to longer wavelengths. And longer wavelengths is less energy. That's energy per photon, okay? So if any of you has seen this before, one of the models of quantum mechanics is a particle in a box. We can think about these systems as having one electron that can freely move in here. And depending on the length of this, depending on this size and how long it can move, the difference in energy between two states. And depending on the difference in energy between two states, where I expect to find the absorption, what colors of light that chromophore will absorb. And as you can see in here, when I make this, it looks like it's like a box where my electron can move. When I make this longer, I can shift my spectrum to one region or another one. And this goes back to the question of, why organics. One of the reasons is that you can play this game. You can change the nature of these chromophores to go farther to the right. Yes. You want to have, absolutely, you want to have something that absorbs as broader as possible, and you'll see much more complicated molecules later on, as broader as possible, and you actually want to match the spectrum that we see from the sun arriving to Earth. That's not the spectrum coming out of the sun because the atmosphere absorbs some, but there is what's called the AM, there is a spectrum, characteristic spectrum of the sun at every place on Earth, and you can try to match that. And there's tons of research because it's very, very hard to do that. That's why we do this research, to try to do that. So there are ways of combining these chromophores. You have one in here. You have another one in there. I could actually make another chromophore that will look like this. Two, it has three units, but they are in a, what it's called in this case, a meta substitution. That means, you have this angle in here instead of being linear. And that changes again the spectrum of the absorption spectrum. In this case, this molecule, even though it has three units, the absorption spectrum looks like this one in here. That's what the red and the blue correspond to. It looks like having two units, each one, two chromophores, each one of two units. There is really a lot of game playing on the architecture and on the chemical structure of this system to try to modify the spectrum of the molecule. So I was lucky enough many years ago to read the paper that brought me into this field. And it had to do with the introduction of this molecule in here. This molecule is called the nanostar. It was made by Jeff Moore at Urbana-Champaign. He made some and never again because it was very hard to make, right? But there's an absolutely beautiful molecule to try to understand a lot of the processes that are happening on the system. And why is that? Because if you look in here, every time I have an angle, you see that I have a phenyl group in there, and then an angle in there, and then linear three units, and then an angle in there. What I really have, it's independent chromophores. Even though the chemistry, the molecule in there is all bound together, it looks like these three chromophores are independent from each other. I could think about having a box of the blue length, a box in green, and a box in red, okay? And how do we know that? Because if I make individually this molecule, and that one, and I make their spectrum, they look like this. The one that has two rings look like this blue line in there. The one that has three rings, the absorption spectrum looks like the green in here. And the one that has the four rings, it looks like this magenta. And if I now combine those together, and I count how many times I have each of these chromophores. If you go in here, I have, you see that there are four linear units in here and four linear units in there. So I take this magenta spectrum and multiply by two. And then I count how many I have that are three linear. I have one, two, three, four. So I take the green spectrum and multiply by four. And then the other one I have 24, if I remember correctly. If I do that and I put it all together, I actually get the spectrum of this molecule. This is the spectrum of the molecule at collected at 10 Kelvin, the absorption spectrum. And it becomes much more complicated, but I can understand it because I go ahead and said, oh, look, I know that it has twice the spectrum in magenta, four times the spectrum in green, and 24 times the spectrum in blue. Okay? Moreover, if you keep in mind that as you go longer in wavelength, you are decreasing the energy. What I have in here is a bias of the energy in that direction. That means that if my sample absorbs energy in here, that energy is going to try to trickle down all the way to here. It's actually going to trickle down to this area where I haven't shown you the spectrum, but this is what we use to probe the system. This is a molecule that absorbs even farther, you know, to lower energies, and we can detect what's coming out of it very easily. So we use that as a way of probing it. So we want to be able to understand that process. Ooh, I'm going to, okay. So what is that process? That's a process of energy transfer. And that means that you have two molecular systems. In here you have a donor system, and in here you have an acceptor. There is a coupling, a connection between them, that it's a connection because they see each other, they feel each other, but there's no absorption or emission of photons in there. They just interact with each other. They are coupled with each other. The strength of this couple tells you how fast, if I excite my donor molecule, how fast that energy is going to go into my acceptor. And how fast is that? It's very, very fast if I want to have an efficient system. So when you go through the calculations and you come out with the time scale associated with the transfer, for a system to be efficient, the transfer is going to occur in about 10 to the minus 14 to 10 to the minus 12 seconds. The units in there, it's about 10 femtoseconds to a picosecond. Why is that, or why do we need it to be like that? Because if you think of a molecule that is on the excited state, is, you know, absorb light, is very excited, it has a lot of energy, you know, that is extra. And I want this energy to reach one particular place. It has to go very quickly before it has any time to put that energy anywhere else. So to have a light harvester, you have to have something that's extremely efficient. And to be extremely efficient, it has to happen very fast. So if it happens very fast, and I want to understand it, how do I do that? How do I look at something that changes very fast with time? The way that we do that is by looking at time-resolved experiments, which is the same thing as, okay, I'm going to show how old I am. When I was your age, and I will go disco, whatever, you know, we call disco at that time, we have this stroboscopic lamp, right? And we will go dancing, and you will see, I don't even know if they still have them now. It's embarrassing, all right? I don't know if they have them now or not, but, you know, you see the lights turning on and off, and you will see somebody moving like this, right? Well, the faster you go with the stroboscopic lamp, the more that the smoother the motion will look. Because what you're really doing is like taking pictures of slices in time. And the closer the slices in time they are, the more you can actually see how it moves. We do the same thing in a different time scale, but we do exactly the same thing. So you can do it on a picture by actually looking, for example, in this case, how a ballerina moves. You know, you take all these pictures, and then you can understand things that happen on time by taking static pictures. Well, we do the same thing. The only difference is that we do it on 10 to the minus 12 to 10 to the minus 14 seconds. How do we do that? We do an experiment in which we come first with a laser, and we excite the sample. We use a laser to mimic the sun. So the molecule, these chromophores, absorb light, and when they absorb light, they get excited. And then we come with another laser pulse that is very short. Oh, sorry, before that. So that molecule, once it absorbs light, is going to do something. It's going to get rid of that energy in one way or another. So it's going to have some property that is going to change with time. I identify what that property is. That property can be emission, photoluminescence. It can be changes in the absorption spectrum. Whatever property it is, that's what I'm going to identify, and I'm going to try to follow it in time. How do I follow it in time? I come with another pulse, another laser pulse, and I use this to take pictures of slices of time of that property. Okay? And as I take these pictures at the very, very beginning, that property is going to be maximum, and then it's going to change with time. It's going to decay. And I take this as my stroboscopic lamp that turns on and off, so it allows me to follow that property in time. So the same way that this motion occurs on seconds, we actually look at a property that changes on 750 femtoseconds, 750 times to the minus 12 seconds. The instrumentation, as you saw in the very first picture where all the students and postdocs were there, the instrumentation is quite complicated. It's becoming easier and easier with time because things that were only possible to have homemade before, they are now commercial. Expensive, but commercial, so you can get them in there. But the idea is that we generate, we have this bunch of lasers in there, and we play with optics. And I personally, this is the part that I really, really like because I like to work with my hands. I like to design instruments, and I like to be in the lab. You know, I don't spend as much time now in the lab as I used to, but I like to build things. And for a student that is working in a lab within my group, that's what we do. We spend a lot of the time building and rebuilding things. These are several of the instruments. You can see in here the students on the back, two of them. This is me 10 years ago. This is the first students that actually were in the lab. This is a college student. She started as a freshman, so pretty much where you are now. That's when she started coming to the lab. She was a PhD student in there. So what are the systems that we look into? We look at these molecular systems that, for all the purposes that we care about now, have two areas. This is the area in which the light will be collected. And this is what is going to allow us to probe how the energy moves around. And what we do is we look at the energetics of the backbone, this area in here, and the trap. This is the paralleling unit that allows us to probe the system. So we excite with a laser, and then we see how long it takes for the energy that we put in here to reach that place in there. And what we observed that was very interesting is that actually there are two different pathways for the energy to go from this backbone to, from this periphery to that trap. One that connected directly and one that had two different steps on it. And we can test this by looking at light that will leak out of the molecular system as it was going through sort of the intermediate steps. So we can follow in time what was happening in there. And this is the data that I showed before to explain the instrument. But we can actually follow in time what happens with the population of each of these states as the times go by. We can do that with molecules that are much more complicated, more complex than this one. This is the molecule that I showed you before. So whereas on the previous molecule, we had two paths, if I do a sequence of experiments in here in which I excite different areas so I can start my experiment at different wavelengths, what I end up getting is that depending where I excite, I start getting much more complicated pathways for energy transfer. But you can see that all of them, if you look at the units, they all happen on a very fast time scale. And this is sort of the different properties that we follow that give us an understanding of what's happening on the molecular system. We test our models by predicting how particular signal will look like, not fitting it, but just predicting what it will look like. And then we come along and said, OK, the black curve is the prediction. The one that has the noise, of course, is the experiment. So we can see that what we predicted should be happening, if we understand the model correctly, it's what actually happens in there. So this allows us to understand how this molecule can absorb light, anywhere from 250 to 400 nanometers, and all that light, all that energy is going to reach this sink in here. I'm going to skip. Yes, I'm going to skip this because I'm running out of time. But I will tell you that we can actually also do what is called electronic structure calculation, in which you actually look, do computational work to understand of what happens from the theoretical perspective, and actually this allows us to understand the experiments that we are trying to measure. The experiments, you know, we have a lot of experiments that we've done, and to understand how they're working, it is fundamental that we do the theoretical companion work of it. We can look at systems that are as complex as the ones that I showed before, or as simple as this one that has, it doesn't show very well, but it has two units in here, three in there, and four in there. So we simplified our molecular system so we can model something better. And the idea is that you always try to do the simplest model possible to understand a very complex molecular system. And what we can see in here is that when we look at the electronic part, when we look at where the excited state of the electrons are, we can see how it moves from one part of the molecule. It follows like this. It moves from one part of the molecule to another one, reaching this place in here. But we can also see that the same type of behavior happens when we try to look at, if you look at this molecule, two things are happening at the same time. One is the electrons are getting excited, and that's what we want, because then we are going to separate the charges. But the other thing is that this process can happen because when I look at a carbon-carbon distance, that distance tells me how much my molecule is moving. And what we were able to find out was that the same process, at the same time that we were seeing this with the electronic part of the molecule, the same was happening with particular carbon-carbon bonds on the molecular system. And what you have in here is that if you imagine that you have two of these carbons, they're moving like this, we measured that distance, and as the energy goes from one place of the molecule to another one, I get this more excited or at least less excited. That's the idea in there. And then finally, we can also understand how when you're trying to find a good light harvester, you have to look for a material that can take the energy and focus it in one place through multiple pathways. Because if one of them is blocked, the molecule can always use the other one. And one example in here is a system in which we look, this is a calculation, but it allows us to understand what's happening. If you look at the one on the left, I think I can run them at the same time and keep them running. And you look at the one on the right, where is it? There. As they keep running, I'll try to show you, you know, what I mean by that. Yes, okay. If you look at the one on the left, when it starts zero, everything is in here. And then there's one jump and goes in there. This is a good measurement of where the energy is going. Spatially, it goes from one place to the other, and that's it, and it stays there. That's one path. The other path, it's in here. If you start at zero, you can see that the energy bounces back and forth between these two arms. And only after a few times of bouncing back and forth, the energy goes to the bottom. These are two different mechanisms that allow the energy to actually reach this trap, this sink in here. And what is plotted at the bottom is, it's describing one of them, and then you have like one drop and that's it. Whereas in here, you know, the energy goes like this between the two halves until it reaches the bottom. And then when it reaches the bottom, it remains in there. So in essence, what we try to do is to understand these fundamental mechanisms that will take the energy for this sort of bouquet-like type of molecules where you have a lot of chromophores at the edges, and we try to specially focus in one place. And then you can use that energy for the next step, which is the separation of charges. These molecules, as I said at the beginning, they're absorbing the UV part of the spectrum. They're not very friendly for the sun. So you can explore modifying them. You want to also have molecules that are easy to make, processable. So if you're trying to make an actual organic photovoltaic, you want a molecule that is soluble, for example, in polar solvents, water or alcohol, because it's a lot easier to make the manufacturing of it. So what we actually do is we compare the previous molecules that I show you with, this will be this non-ionic one, with similar molecules, but they actually have charges on them. And we do that to see whether the processes associated with energy transfer are the same. And what you really, what I really want you to get from here is that if you look, these are three different cartoons of three different molecular systems. And the first one doesn't have any energy transfer. These two do have. But the shape of the, you know, the signal versus time is very similar in all of them. So in essence, what we learn from these molecules that might not be very good for an application can be transferred into a molecule that will be much better for an application. And that's kind of how fundamental science works. You sort of look at a model system, you look at something that you can understand all the parameters and you can vary them one at a time so you know what you're doing. And then whatever you learn from there, you apply it into a system that might have a more direct application but might be a lot harder to handle. So with that, you know, I have sort of a summary in here of the things that we found. The wording in here might not be exactly the words that I say, but in essence, this is kind of what we learn on the systems. One is to say that we have these chromophores that have different energies, that they are going to bias how the energy go from you know, the high energy absorber to a sink where we can then extract that energy for something else. The processes occurs between 400 femtoseconds and 1.5 picoseconds. This is 410 to the minus 15 to 1500 10 to the minus 15. I haven't talked about the coherent control part, but the idea is that you have parallel pathways. You have multiple pathways of energy transfer from one area of the molecule to the to the focus part, and that makes that's a good option for harvesting. And then the idea that we can understand that we have to have the atoms moving to facilitate the process of the energy moving through the system. With that, I'm going to go back to the picture of the students because at the end it's them who do most of the work. So as I said, it's not super actual, but I can show you. This is the girl that you saw in the other picture, and Kirsten is not here. All right, and the other one is not, the picture of her is not here. But this is a group of people that go from undergrad students to graduate students to postdocs, you know, sort of all over the place and have been in the group over the years. And it's kind of fun to work with them. So with that, I'll thank you for your attention. And if you have any more questions, I'll be happy to answer.